It's time for the Giz Wiz with Mad's maddest rider, Dick DeBartolo. This is episode 1616, recorded Thursday, March 30th, 2017. Snake oil in a box. On this episode of the Giz Wiz, we have three gadgets from the luxury technology show, ooh la la, the end of my security month, and your videos. All next on the Giz Wiz!
It's the same dumb show with Dickie D and OMG chat on your PC. It's time for the Giz Wiz because gadgets are his business. They've got a gizmo sickness, geek disease,
under pathology,
rows and rows of USBs, growing blowing LEDs. Get ready for the Giz Wiz now.
Now it is time for the Giz Wiz, and here he is, the genius of gadgets, Dick DeBartolo. How you doing, Dickie D?
I'm doing good, sir. And you?
Doing well myself. Doing pretty good, I gotta say.
Good.
What else has been going on this last week for you?
Well, my boat is down the Jersey Shore.
What?
Waiting.
Is that where it's supposed to be?
Waiting for the new engine. And, you know, it's very funny because originally I was just getting what was called a Yamaha mechanical engine, which meant they just take my old engine off, drop the new one on, and I drive away.
Right.
And then just as they were ordering it, they said, oh my God, we just saw a picture of your boat and you have a 30-inch engine and they don't make this new engine in that size.
What?
Yeah, I know. Because I have a kind of a work boat, which requires this very long. So anyway, I said, well, you have to get one of the new digital engines, which means nothing on your boat, nothing you own will work.
So are the pixels really nice on it because it's so digital?
What's the resolution like? I don't have the boat here, so we're doing all of this by
email.
Email and text and photographs. And I mean, when it's done, it's going to be like thousands more than I thought.
Oh, no.
But evidently, the shift is like electronic and instead of gauges, I have one big gauge and I just tell it, you be this part of you be the speedometer, that part of you be the tachometer, this side, tell me the water temperature. Anyway, so it's exciting, expensive, but ultimately going to be, I think, great.
Wow. So you're going to get it and the console is going to be completely different.
Yes, they have to put wood grain over all the old instruments.
Oh, so man. It looks like, yes, I know. That's insane. That's crazy.
I know.
Now,
I know.
You know, I would assume as not a boat person that a boat is easier to work on because the engine's right there. It's at the back of the boat. You just flip it out. Is that true or is it just about the same as like replacing an engine in a car?
Well, you know what? Never owning a car, the thing is now so that the engines don't make any noise. I mean, the new four-stroke outboards are not new. They've been around for like 15 years. But they are so quiet that when they first came out, I remember gassing up and the gas attendant was getting ready to throw my line off. And I said to him, I'm set, you can throw my line off. And he said, well, I'm waiting for you to start the engine. I said, my engine is running. He said, what? I said, yeah, it's one of the new four star. So they're super quiet. But in order to have that happen, the engines like are inside a shroud. So you need about 50 different tools to even see the engine.
My dad's fishing boat had a
back. No, the mechanic doesn't come down with a toolbox. The mechanic comes down with a laptop.
Yeah, wow.
And plugs the laptop into the side of your outboard, and then the laptop tells him what's wrong with it, and then it also tells you be prepared to put out $4,000.
Exactly.
They won me. There's nothing you can repair on this engine. You know, when your dad had it, when I got my first engine, hey, I'm going to put in spark plugs. Oh, I'm going to do, you don't do any of this.
No,
the engine knows all and wants you to keep away.
Weird. Okay. Yeah. Wow. That sounds ridiculous and not in a bad way. It's just like, oh my gosh.
It's a different world.
Big thing that's going on with your boat right now. Like,
yes.
Wow. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And you, what's new with you and your little world?
Nothing much. This last week, you know, it's getting into spring. And so I've been kind of working on the house, doing a little bit of gardening. And remulching and stuff like that. It seems like my grass right now, the only place that it wants to grow is in the mulch, which is the one place it shouldn't grow. Everywhere else it's dead because it hasn't rained enough. Anyway.
So, do you have half an acre or a quarter of an acre or 3 feet?
I'd have to know exactly how it's bigger than it's. I mean, I don't know exactly how big an acre.
You have a driveway.
I have a driveway. So
a separate garage.
It's not. It's part of the house.
Okay.
It's I have an alley. In fact, how they build homes around here is there's a main street. You know, you have your normal street, and then in the back of the houses, there's actually a second alley. So there's normal streets, and then a little thing. So that's where my garage is. So if you pull up to the front of my house. There's no garage on the front of it. That's in the back of the house, which is kind of nice because at my parents' place in Austin, Texas, anytime you took out the trash, you had to take it in immediately. You know, we had bins. It wasn't like New York.
Oh, right. Yes, yes.
So you take out the trash bin. Well, you got to get it back inside by noon that day. Otherwise, people start sending you letters. The Homeowners Association gets mad at you, or your neighbors come by and go, hey, you got your trash bin out in front of your house. Here, because it's an alley, and only us neighbors see it in the alley, I forget to bring in the trash bin all the time. It's so much easier to kind of just have this thing back there. So that's nice.
Sounds good.
I mean, it's enough. It's enough that if I was to start mowing, it takes me about 20 to 30 minutes on a normal push mower to get the whole. To whole front and backyard and stuff like that. So that's an idea. I don't know exactly how big it is.
Well, I would, I think if you take the bowl off that mixer, you could actually mow that lawn in about 5 minutes.
I need the voice. I need one of those robot lawnmowers. That's what I want is a lawnmower. I just go on, mow the lawn. that'd be awesome. But one day, how cool would that be?
Big, very, very cool.
You know, did you not see any of this at the luxury technology show?
No, but I did see. I saw one very inexpensive gadget. But I think the most interesting thing is the first gadget we're going to talk about, which is the $99 3D printer. Okay, so let's start with that. And it turns out that the reason it's $99 is that your smartphone is half of this printer. So let's watch the video.
Hey, Dick DeBartolo, Mads Maddest Writer, and the Giz Wiz, One Take Theater here at the Luxury Technology Show. And I'm walking by and I see a $99 3D printer, and I said, oh no! But the name of the company is Ono, and Helene is going to tell us how this works.
Absolutely, I'd be happy to do that. So it's actually really, really simple. The printer is composed of two parts. All right, you have the actual printer on the top, and then this is the protective case. You place your phone at the bottom of it. All right. This will come.
So your phone is part of the printing process.
Yes, absolutely. So usually how resin hardened is through UV light, but we developed this resin that hardens with visible light. So the light from your phone will harden the resin. And how it does that is through our app. It will create the image that you created that you uploaded to our cloud. It will be a bunch of images sliced into black and white.
So a bunch of images, it might be like thousands, right, or hundreds?
Well, it depends on the design that you made, right? So if it's something as like this, it'll be, you see, these parts right here will be white, and then the area in between will be black.
Okay, was everything on these two little display stands printed with this device?
Absolutely, yes, everything.
Okay, and give me a vague idea of how many hours or minutes it might have taken to print something like that.
Well, it depends on how heavy your object is, and if it's hollow or if it's full. This will take about 30 minutes to print, and then, I mean, something as complex and as heavy as this could take up to 4 hours.
Okay, and so we can print anything that fits into...
Yes, onto the display of your phone.
Okay, so is it out now?
We just started launching, we just started delivering printers to our backers today. The next month it will be available to everyone worldwide.
And now the resin comes from where?
Every resin is different. It has a different consistency. They go from really, really hard rock resin to more flexible ones. Right, thank you. Like this.
Wow.
Depending on what you want to print.
Okay, and how much are the bottles of resin?
They're 100 milliliters, and they go for $15.
$15, okay. Oh, can I print my teeth?
You could if you want to.
Dicky Bartolo, Man's Medist Writer, and the Giz Wiz, One Take Theater here at gizwiz.tv. The next time you see me, I will have gold teeth.
That is incredible that A, the price point, and B, that it's using your phone as the catalyst to
exactly
to change,
and you know what,
the resin around.
They have a little 1 minute video on their website that has a cutaway so we can see how that operates.
I think
it's kind of clever.
This video, possibly.
You know what? That might be it.
Here's a video of it. So he's choosing what he wants to make. He's setting his phone down, plugging in an audio cable, looks like, and then setting that device on top.
Exactly. Now this has one wall cutaway.
Right.
So now
he's pouring resin directly onto his screen.
God, well, now don't forget,
terrifying.
There's a little layer between your phone.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Yeah, that's terrifying.
And now the 3D print head. I guess it's getting, I'm not quite sure where it's getting the power from.
It looks like you just plugged in some sort of USB thing in
right.
the side.
So now
wow.
it's building. It builds it upside down. It's going to come
right.
out.
Wow, that is incredible. So, you know, and I've had some fun. You're right. There's a plastic thing there in the way. So you kind of wash it off. And there you go. Now you have your construction. That is interesting. By the way, we don't have a very good history of companies named Ono or any no in the title.
Well, you know what? Go to the Kickstarter thing for a second. I think I put the link there. First of all, they got almost three. It used to be called Olo.
Oh, you're like, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, and they changed
Olo.
Maybe there is an Olo company or something.
Right.
But they took the logo and changed it around. But they got
$2 million.
Almost 3 million. Back then. Oh, okay. Yes.
Yeah.
2 million.
Almost 2.5. It's 2.
Yeah.
2.3 million dollars.
Dollars.
Oh my
yeah,
gosh.
I know. I know.
I could make a 3D printer for $2 million. That's incredible. It's a really, really neat concept because I've mostly, most of the 3D printers that I've seen have not used this resin technology. They use the plastic, the PVC plastic technology. I'm trying to think of the word, PLA plastic.
PLA, okay,
That melts the plastic through an extrusion head, and then it puts that on layer by layer. So this is a different technology than I've seen that I've had experience with, but looks just the same, that there's a resin that hardens with visible light, and you build up your 3D print layer by layer using your phone as the device that hardens. That's incredible. And
it's pretty interesting, isn't it?
That's pretty interesting. I am impressed. And it only being $100 is also just really cool. And also,
yeah.
it seems really portable. The 3D printer that I have the most experience with is this one. It's the Monoprice Select Mini Printer. And it's double the price at $200. And portability doesn't exist, basically.
No.
I mean, there's no way you're going to throw this into a... into a suitcase or anything like that. And so to see this printer that is doesn't take up that much space, and the resin, I assume you can pour the resin back into the bottle and use it again.
Yes, she said that, like that honeycomb thing that she made, she said you could make three of those with one bottle of resin.
Wow. That's very
it's very clever. I think it's very clever, and the fact that they raised $2.25 million, and all these things are printed on it that we're looking at on the screen. So they got 16,000 orders, which they're filling between now and early April, and then they will start shipping $99 printers to people who order them online.
Wow. Very, very cool. I like
Isn't
this
that
one.
Neat?
I like this one a lot. And also, I got to be honest, from the printers that I've used, user interface is a big problem. that Monoprice printer, I had to use this program on my computer, then transfer it to an SD card, then put the SD card into the device, then choose it from a menu on the device and start printing. It's not that intuitive. And in fact, that was considered an intuitive way to do it. A lot, you have to like create a USB server on your computer that when you plug in the USB cord, then it talks to that, and you can submit jobs to your internal server, and then it pushes them over the USB. And if you lose USB connection, like you accidentally unplug the USB, then your whole print job is totally canceled in the middle. There's no way to restart. I mean, it's just like some really wonky ways to do 3D printing. Using your phone seems like a much simpler solution.
Right. The only problem is if you're printing a vase and you get a phone call, the middle of the vase is like, they go, what happened to your vase? What? Oh, my mother called.
Is this your mother's face in this vase?
Yeah, I was just going to say, my mother called and that's her chin in the middle of the vase.
Exactly.
No, it's pretty neat.
Maybe put your phone in airplane mode before you start 3D printing. It's a little bit of a...
Hopefully the hardware is smart enough to ignore everything else when it's printing.
Exactly.
So now the official name is Ono and not Olo for some bizarre reason that they started out as.
You can find that at ONO3D.net. O-N-O is how you spell Ono.
Right, Ono. Second one is a little clever device, and the guy's very nice, and I think he made $1 million really fast with the iRing. So this is it.
Hey, Dick DeBartolo, Maz Madestrider, and the Giz Wiz. One Take Theater here at GizWiz.tv. Still at the Luxury Technology Show. We're walking by and I see a thing called the iRing. And Jay is going to tell us what it is and what it does and how it's going to make me $1 million.
You already made me $1 million.
Oh, damn, I wasn't fast enough.
So this iRing. It's a detachable accessory. You could also, you see the ring, is turn it 360, you could fold it down. You could also peel this thing on and off as many times as you like. It holds up to 15 pounds, so this is great also as well for iPads. You could position it wherever you like, put it on, give it a little squeeze, and now what do you have? Multiple uses. How many times you need to watch videos? How many times do you go to a restaurant and you actually see a parent leaning the device for their child against a salt and pepper shaker?
Well, on an airplane, you always stack things up.
On an airplane, pull this thing up, hook it right onto the tray. You see the tray hook?
Oh, right.
Hook
it right on.
Hook it right on there.
Oh, I like that. Yeah.
Yes. pictures. No more two-handed picture taking. Now, everything's one hand. With the security, with the feeling that you're never gonna drop it. How many times do you see people doing group selfies?
3,410.
And the left hand is always gets in the way of the camera. Now, you're your own selfie stick. No more.
All right, so now, what's in the box? Because it looked like there was more than the ring in the box.
Yes, let me. We have, it comes with the hook.
Now, go ahead.
These hooks, you could peel the back of the adhesive and you put it on anywhere you like, in the bathroom, in the kitchen, the dashboard of your car. And what this hook does is your phone hangs right on it and clicks right on. For example, now if you're in the car, you want navigation. Now, no, everyone uses either Google Maps or Waze for navigation. They don't use that navigation in their cars anymore. You want nav? Turn it. 90 degrees.
Okay. Now, Jay, is the mount, can you take that off and put it elsewhere like
Great
the hook?
Good question. The mount is one time.
The mount is one time.
Yes.
Okay.
So you have to pick that spot where you really want it.
Okay. Or buy a new car if you put it in the wrong spot.
I'll buy the car for you.
So, Jay, what does this cost? What is it retail?
$1,995 retail.
$1,995. And your website is?
iRing.com.
iRing.com. Are you in stores?
Yes, we are. We're in the wireless stores. We're in T-Mobile. We're in Verizon Wireless. We're in Sam's Club.
Okay, that's good. I like it. Dick DeBartolo, Mads Medis, writer, and the Giz Wiz One Take Theater here at gizwiz.tv. Bye.
Very cool. Yeah, I've seen kind of some competitors in this space.
Yes.
I like that you can pull it off and pull it on. Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
The thing that pops to mind is the Pop Sockets is a big competitor in this space. But there's a few things about that I do like. I like that it's an actual ring, so you can hook it onto things, like he was saying. I've seen those hooks around that, you wonder, what is that little hook at the back of the, is that for your jacket? It seems a little silly. Anyway.
My favorite thing is the on-off, because sometimes you think,
yes.
First of all, you may want to move it to a new phone.
Right.
But whatever it is, you don't want something glued permanently onto your phone. So
exactly.
that's a big plus.
Yeah, and that's the problem with my pop socket. I used a pop socket for a while on a phone case, and I purposely put on a phone case just so that I wouldn't have it permanently attached to my phone in case I didn't want it later. And also, there's sometimes when you might want it in the center of your phone for carrying around, but then you know you're going to sit there for an hour and a half and watch a movie. But if it's just 2 centimeters down, it's so much better to prop it up. So I really enjoyed that.
I like the thing that it can hook on a snack tray hook.
Right.
Because when after a while your neck hurts when you have it on your snack tray and you're looking down. And I often stack magazines in the seat pocket. Yeah. And try and balance the phone on top of the magazine so I can be looking dead ahead. And it works great for about 3 minutes, and then it slowly vibrates and falls into the pocket, or worse, falls onto the floor, and you have to go find your phone. So I like the idea that you could hook it onto that snack tray hook. Even
Seems
if
great.
The snack tray is open, the hook stays there.
Seems great. So. The cost on Amazon is $19.95 for, looks like all of these different colors.
There are bunches. I thought
There's
they came in all different colors.
They do. This is
a
red
okay.
one. Here's a pink one. Here's a black one. This is a gold one. Amazon is, of course, doing this thing where no matter between all the different colors, you'll get a different price for every different color.
Oh, yes. It's very funny.
If you want it in blue, you save $5. If you want it in black, it's the normal retail price. So, click around and find the color that you want, basically. Looks like there's even two blacks. This is one version of black, and here's the other version of black. And then finally, here's, oh, this is navy. Oh, I clicked navy.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, if you don't mind silver.
How much is pink? Normally pink and blue are cheap. Oh, what's the cheap?
Silver.
What's
the silver is the cheapest.
Silver, that's a great color.
That's a fantastic color. So get silver.
Go.
There you go.
$13. Oh, yeah.
If it comes in matte black, I hope it doesn't cost $1,000. inside joke, sorry. And so there it is, the iRing. I like it. I think that that's a fantastic product. And has some nice features compared to some of the stuff, the competition that I've seen.
Yeah.
So.
And it's stainless. And I read some of the people who bought knockoffs and said the ring broke. And my fear of buying the knockoff would be that it would have some sort of glue on it that.
Right. Left a residue.
Permanently. Yes,
right,
exactly.
Exactly.
It permanently is stuck to your phone. Okay. Our final guy was, there was a press release that said we make the Lego of projectors, and I'm thinking the Lego of what is anyway. So let's take a look at the Lego system.
Hey, Dick DeBartolo, Maz Metis writer, and the Giz Wiz, One Take Theater here at GizWiz.tv. Aptech mobile projection systems. Now, I got a press release. Oh, introduce yourself to us.
Okay, my name is Jamie. We are a Taiwanese-based company, and we are the leader of the mobile projection company.
Okay, now, the press release said that you sold stackable components.
Yes, stackable computing projection system. This is the product here. This is a product called iBeam Block. And this just won the IF Award Design 2017 winner. Okay, and because this is inspired by Lego, and this is stackable, this is the world's first stackable computing projection system.
Now, so this is a tablet?
Yeah, this is tablet, it's a Windows 10 tablet.
Okay, Windows 10?
Yeah, Windows 10 is like a computer. And this is the projector, and this is the power bank. So basically, you are watching the small PC on hand because it's literally a computer.
So okay. This would be great for a salesman on the road?
Yes, yes, salesman on the road.
Is that coming from one of your products?
Yes, actually, it's there.
Oh, okay. Yes. Dennis, on that chair.
Yes, we are demonstration over there. Okay, so on the top is a Windows 10 tablet.
Now, what does this retail for?
This will be $699.
$699?
Right.
For all three?
Yes, all three.
Okay, and
one device.
And when you're using the projector, how many hours of battery life can you get?
2 hours.
2 hours is pretty good.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Yeah,
okay.
You can watch a movie and do presentation. Very good for conference also.
And is it on the market now?
Yes, we just launched in market.
In market.
You can find it on Amazon.
Okay, and your website is?
www.globalaptech.com.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
So this is a little insert, something that I hadn't seen before. This is their Boombox mini projector. Okay, so how many speakers in here?
The 40-watt speaker.
A 40-watt speaker?
Yeah, come with four directions. Okay, so it's like you will get the surrounding sound.
Wow, and how many hours can this play?
4 hours.
Four hours. So twice the...
On the top, it's an Android tablet. So, okay, I put the file on Dropbox, for example, so I can show you the video.
Okay, and now we're looking at the wall here. And how big is that screen? Is that like 100 inches?
Yeah, more than that.
More than that.
120, 150 inches, no problem, as long as your environment is dark enough. Right.
Okay. Right. And this product is called?
It's called P800.
Great. Dick DeBartolo, Maz Metis writer, and the Giz Wiz, One Take Theater here at the Luxury Technology Show. Bye.
That seems pretty luxury, I gotta say. The the Windows 10 tablet, projector, power bank, everything seems pretty incredible. And that also seems perfect for someone who needs a, you know, not many projectors are built in with any type of computer. You have to hook your computer up. But if you're in a situation
yes.
like at a trade show or in, you're moving a professor that moves around, having something built in is pretty nice. I think that's cool.
Yeah, and if you're doing a demo, you know, you're using the Windows 10. I noticed, I didn't realize it when I recorded it, or Dennis recorded it, is that the boombox thing seems to have an Android tablet on it, but the little iBeam is a Windows 10 computer. I guess you can probably get either one of them. But it's kind of clever. And when I was researching, it turns out they make a ton of projection equipment. So that they've been around a while. Anyway, so that's a
I do wonder, you know, my brain immediately jumps to, what else would you use this for? You know, like you have the power bank. What else would you use that power bank for if not only for this one projector? Same thing with the tablet on top. And if they fit so perfectly together, it seems kind of like you're not.
Oh, what else do you do? Yeah. I do think that.
Legos. You can put Legos in any configuration.
Right.
But you can only
I do think the power bank does have USB out. So you can at least use it to charge other devices. But you're right. They're kind of a match set that can do exactly, you know. I would figure a salesman would find this ideal to, on the airplane and stuff, you know, work on presentations, keep the projector thing in his suitcase or his backpack. Then when he gets to the client, just do the presentation. Don't even need electricity if he's certainly not going to do a 2-hour presentation and put everybody to sleep. So it's pretty.
And there's something that this tablet is built for this projector.
Yes.
Once you get that video file running on that tablet, nothing should go wrong because they're all kind of made to work together. So I agree. There's plenty of scenarios that someone's going to be going, oh my gosh, yes. Please, yes. In fact, even, I used to work for Brian Brushwood.
Yes.
With his stage show. We carried a little travel projector with us just in case the college that we were going to didn't have one. This would have, depending on how much light it produces, this would have been just fine to carry around with us.
Especially the bigger one if you were in a larger auditorium.
Exactly.
But the funny thing is, after Dennis shot that, he said, didn't I record something like this at another event? And I was thinking, and I said, oh, you mean Stax from Lenovo? And I think I put a link to what Stax from Lenovo is. It should be there on your notes. Okay, there you go. So now they said one of the things they might do in the future is add a projector. So here they are stacking a Bluetooth speaker system, a power bank. I forgot what else they were doing.
SSD a solid state drive.
Yes, exactly. So it was something you could add to a mini computer. You could add more memory. You could add more battery. You could add a Bluetooth speaker system. But in reality, I think they probably hook up pretty much the same. You just drop them one on top of the other in any order, and they're connected. So. Right. It's actually a clever way to save wiring, and as you said, not worry that you left the cable someplace.
Exactly. Very cool. Interesting. Someone just found in the chat room the Kickstarter for this iBeam thing.
Did they fail?
It says funding suspended. I don't know what that means. I don't know what that means.
What does that mean?
I don't know. It says suspended.
Wow.
It's been suspended.
They didn't even get half of what they wanted.
Yeah. I don't know what
Too many people were buying a $99 printer.
Exactly. Exactly. They go, dang it, if only that printer company could just go away, because they're taking all of our credibility. Yeah.
No, and I never saw suspended.
Me neither.
Do you know what they put up? Maybe the chat room knows. If you don't make your funding, is it a different word? Do they say
suspended
funding
seems
not
harsh.
Met, maybe, right?
It seems pretty harsh.
Yes.
To say suspended.
Suspended.
You've been suspended.
Maybe they were late for class or something. Someone's saying it could be a copyright problem. Someone privately funded it.
Right. It could be also.
Maybe Logo said, stop saying it's Logo.
Possibly. I mean, if I look right here, here's the project concept with the Lego blocks. And it could have easily been Lego said, no, sir, can you use our imagery?
That could be. That's exactly. Very funny.
Okay. Well.
All right. Well, that means we have your final Chad's Crappy Corner.
Chad's Crappy Corner. Get it.
Okay. So this gadget I saw and I don't know about it. And I still don't know about it.
Okay.
So I went and I kind of wanted to see if there was any as seen on TV products that would fall into this category, because those tend to give us a good bit of entertainment.
And yes, absolutely.
I found this gadget that could help with car security in a few different ways. It is the Clear Dash HD camera. Looks like this is the packaging. And I saw this, this was actually bought at Walmart for $26. You can also find it online for around $15 to $16. So really, really inexpensive dash cam. And if you don't know what a dash cam is, it's a camera that you put on your windshield to record out the dash of your car. And then it records everything that happens. So in the event that there's an accident or something that you need evidence of, you have a recording. And the best dash cams record in high definition. They have a wide angle lens to get the whole street. And they do what is called loop recording, so that it will record over old footage that it has. And this seemed to do quite a lot of that. It claims.
And Chad, how long is the loop? Like, is it like 10 minutes or 20 minutes? Or
so
do
you can set so there's two kind of things to kind of set the loop. There is how long the video file is, and then how big your memory card that you put inside of it is.
Oh, okay.
So if you have an 8 GB memory card, at that point, it doesn't quite matter how big your files will be, but let's say you set it to be about 5 minutes. That way you can fit around, 20 5-minute clips on there, and then it'll start overwriting at the end of that. So there's that.
You can have 20 car crashes as long as each crash is no more than 5 minutes.
Exactly. And I also have a little bit of experience with dash cams. I purchased a dash cam about 2 years ago, and I've been very happy with it. And so I've been living with my own dash cam, and I kind of know the quirks and features of that cam. And so, it was considerably more expensive than $26. And so I picked up this one because I thought, if it is a good camera, what a great buy to tell people to go and get. Some things that impressed me right off the start was that it has an actual battery. My camera actually just uses a capacitor inside of it instead of a battery. Now, that has its pros and cons. The capacitor doesn't last very long, but it is better in extreme cold and in extreme heat. A normal battery is kind of rated for certain temperatures, but this has a real battery. That means that you can operate it for a long time away from the car. My camera only gets like a few seconds of battery power. You have a power on the back as well as a record button. You have USB over here on the side, USB mini. Instead of micro, it is a mini, and you have an SD card slot right here. Now it's asking me to put in the SD card. It comes with an 8 GB card.
Wow.
Which I was very impressed with. I kind of didn't expect it to have that. So let's go ahead and slide that in there just so that it stops getting angry at me. Oh gosh, we can do it here. There we go. So here's a little LCD screen that comes with it. You can see it has this little green thing up in the top, and you would think that is the screen protector that you could just pull off I seriously have not been able to get that thing off of there. And it doesn't seem like there's an actual screen protector on the front of the screen since buying it. But anyway, going into menus, one of the first quirks that I saw is that you have, you know, kind of a down and an up, and then you have mode. And I would assume that mode is basically your select key, but it isn't. The select key is the record button at the top.
So, I see.
So if you want to go between things, you'd have to go up here and hit the record button in order to select it.
That's
mode
weird.
Seems to only have one function, and that is right when you hit enter, you can kind of select between the movie and the settings. And if you hit mode, it'll switch between those. But once you go down, there's no way to get back up to that. Oh, looks like I just did. Okay, that's interesting. I thought there wasn't any way to do that. It may be that there's some bug that you can't do it in some situations, but mode really only switches between those two things when you're in that one state with it up there. When it comes, it records in VGA. You can set it to 1080p. I'm going to show you the quality difference, and I'm going to do a side-by-side comparison of what the quality of this camera is compared to the camera that I bought about 2 years ago. So far, I haven't had this long enough to determine exactly how long it'll stay on battery away from the charge, but it will for a little while. One nice feature is that it does have motion detection. So what you would use that for is it would constantly be recording inside of your car, or you could set it so that it only records on motion, which means that it could be a security camera for your car when you're leaving it in a parking lot or something like that. That is a feature my camera actually does not have. This also, if motion detection is off, what it will do is when it gets power to its mini USB, it will start recording. And then when power is removed, it'll stop recording. And that's how a normal one of these cameras function, so that when you turn on the car, you probably have it plugged in the cigarette lighter already. Once the car turns on, it starts sending power, and then it starts recording. So that's how this one works if motion detection is off. If motion detection is on, then motion detection takes over all. And other than that, there's not a whole bunch of features. So let's get into what the actual video looks like. So in order to do that, I actually have a file here. And first off, this is inside of the Giz Wiz studio. I went ahead and just recorded. One thing I just want to point out is that the screen will not only flip down like this, it will also flip around all the way to the front. So you can kind of use it as a selfie camera just a little bit.
Okay.
And then it'll go a little bit over there. So that's kind of a nice feature as well. And so I actually used it to record this right here. This is inside of this studio just moments before the Giz Wiz. And you can see that even with the perfect amount of light, it's a little bit kind of crazy, grainy.
This is VGA?
This is technically 1080. This is 1080.
Oh.
So that's 1080. Okay. Now, I started recording, so let's go ahead and start this recording here. This is the VGA size. This is, by default, the size that it decides to record at. Very, very, very small. I brought this into a video editor so that you could kind of see the difference between its size and high definition. So this is high definition. You can notice that there are, even while driving around, there are some little artifacts. There's also some audio artifacts. I turn this on mute so that I don't record the conversations of me and my friends in the car. Now, I'm bringing in here, this is my camera. This is the camera that I bought a few years
ago.
You can kind of see a difference.
First off,
the big difference is the wide angle lens. My lens is way more wide angle, and you can see the whole road quite easily. And of course, the color and the actual crispness of the image is very, very different. Now, here's a side-by-side. I tried to get this as perfectly timed as possible. And you can really see a big difference. There's artifacts on the other side, as well as just the difference in what you can see. I mean, I could just go ahead and just pause this video. And you can see that in this video, I can see a car right here, but in this one, I can't. because it's not wide angle enough.
In the video on the right, you live in a much better neighborhood.
Exactly. You don't want to live in the video, in the neighborhood on the left there.
On the left.
Exactly. So there's definitely some downsides. Now, once again, the one that I bought was significantly more expensive. I can't remember at the time, but I do believe that I spent over $100 on my camera. I really wanted a good one. Before we go on here, this is why you would want one of these cameras. This actually happened just today as I was running to pick up the other camera. As I'm driving, a dog ran right in front of my car, and I had to slam on the brakes in order to avoid it. Now, that was a miss, no other cars were involved. But this is the reason why you would want a dash camera. So, this is the ClearDash HD. My final, buy, try, don't buy, or do I recommend it or not recommend it? If you only have $26, $15 to $26 to spend on a dash cam, it's better than nothing. It comes with everything you need. Oh, some of the other features that it comes inside with it. It has a pretty long cigarette lighter. And this is great because what a lot of people do will put this into their armrest lighter, and then they'll run it through and over and up and around and all the way through their car so that the wire is a lot more hidden, so it's not dangling right in front of the thing. They'll actually run it up the side pillar and up and over. So that's good. It also comes with just a normal USB to mini USB cable, and I believe that's also to plug it into your computer if you want to do that.
And how do you charge the battery?
The battery will charge while the car is running. Or if for some reason you want to take it away from the car, you can just plug it in and it'll just charge when it's not in use. I'd say for $15, it's good. I really wouldn't consider this a high definition camera. And I also don't know if I would consider it a wide angle lens camera. All that said, for $17, for $15, however much you can find it, here it is on Amazon, or some competitor like it, and there are plenty of competitors. I would say that it's better than nothing. The reviews weren't that great on Amazon either, coming in. So there you go. Actually, not. These reviews are really bad. Wow. these are some pretty
now,
pretty
now
bad
I
reviews.
Don't have a car. Uh-huh. So if I buy one of these, can I have that SD card that shows the driving so I can pretend I'm in a car?
Exactly. Absolutely.
Oh, okay.
And then the thing is with its motion detection feature, turns this camera into a much more widely usable camera. You could use it on your boat. You could use it if you had some AC plug for some reason in the house, you could put it in a corner and it would loop record until something happened because motion detection will just set it off. So that's it. So it is a little bit crappy, I would definitely say, with the weird button at the top that works instead of the function button.
Did you find that out by trial and error, or
yes.
Did you have to find me?
I was like, this dang button will not work, and I was just thinking, what are the chances? Because I saw at the bottom it said menu to go back, select, or okay to select. And I thought, there is no okay button. There is only a mode button. There's a menu and a mode button. I wonder if there's one of these other buttons does it. It's not going to be power, I don't think. Let me try the record. Well, yeah, that one worked. Okay, well, that's how we move forward in this. So the ClearDash HD camera. As seen on TV. Oh, this is an as seen on TV gadget. So of course, I want to show you the commercial. They run because this is the ClearDash.
She didn't stop. She rear-ended me.
Your Honor, that's not true at all. He backed into me, and my ClearDash HD cam proves it.
Wow, that's not staged.
No, you didn't.
Ran the stop sign.
No, officer, I stopped. You can see it on my ClearDash HD cam.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Have a nice day.
Introduce
wow!
The dashboard cam that gives you instant.
It is not that clear.
Now, the secret that makes the ClearDash HD better than any other.
Oh, look at the video on that.
HD wide-angle technology. It gives you a precisely autofocused, super-wide, HD vivid, 120-degree wide-angle view.
Wow.
Plus, it automatically adjusts for any brightness. Even at night, you get a clear, vivid picture.
I didn't
that
test
captures
it at night.
Every ride from start to finish. ClearDash HD records high definition video and audio on a memory chip that stores 14 hours of drive time. After 14 hours, it's
14 hours, by the way, in standard definition mode. It'll record about 30-ish minutes in 30 to 40 minutes in high definition. And what you'd want to do if you were in an accident, pull the card out so that you have the thing. My anyway, we don't have to watch any more of this. It's lies. These lies that they put on television. You know, in mine, I can set, hey, an event happened. Don't ever delete. Don't ever rewrite over this. I can say an event happened right now. There's a big button on it. You just hit it. And
That's good.
You know, let me see if I can find my... camera. I didn't think about that. Some people may be interested in what my camera was. And here it is. I got the Street Guardian dash cam, formerly the Panorama S, currently unavailable. But this is the one that I ended up buying. I don't see
This is the one that's in your car now.
This is the one that I currently have
I
in my car.
Oh, okay. Okay.
You can see the reviews are slightly different than the reviews on the other one. But yeah, it doesn't say the current price. Well, you know what? We can use Camelizer to figure it out. Looks like it was around $200, $239-ish.
And they closed it out.
Yeah, it looks like it hasn't been
$90, right?
Around for a little while. Or like 100, it's anywhere 180 and 200 is where it normally sat. So I probably bought it at around $190.
Okay.
So yeah.
Well, then you'll have a much better class of accident with that camera.
Exactly. And I've used it. I was in an accident and the insurance said, well, it's hard to tell. I said, well, I have a dash cam. And then a week later, they said, oh, after we told the other guy you had a dash cam, he said it was his fault. I was like, dang right, it was his fault.
The other driver said, it didn't happen to be the clear dash.
Exactly.
HD cam, right?
Huh. Because was that as seen on TV thing? Let's move forward. It was his fault. Yes, exactly. So there you go. That's my crappy corner. That is the end of Security Month. If you are a patron, look forward to giving your input on what the next month's theme will be. So look for that in your emails, patron supporters. Big thanks to you guys. With that, let's jump into Dick's Gadget Warehouse.
They're geeky and they're goofy, together they are loopy. When gadgets pass away, he takes them out to play in Dick's Gadget Warehouse.
Foghorn!
And this is kind of interesting. This is from Steve C. And Steve said, his title of it is The Mystery Box Video. Here's a little mystery box I found at a thrift store. I have no idea what it does, although it seems to be well made. So far, I'm guessing it's either Bigfoot, UFO, or an alien detector. But let's see what the chat room thinks this might be.
What I have here is a little mystery box that I found at a thrift store, and it's a mystery because I have no idea what it is or what it does. It has no manufacturer's name or model number on it or anything, no markings at all, except it says Quantum Pro here on the front. And on the rear, it only has a power connection, a little switch that steps up and down between 0 through 9 and A through F. On the front, there's a volume control-like knob with markings low and high, an on-off switch, a green LED, if you connect power to the thing, the LED will come on, but that seems to be all it does. It has no USB ports, no serial parallel ports, no jacks for speakers or microphones, and it doesn't have Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. But the most amazing thing about this is what's inside. If I open it up, I have the switch on the back so I can take the cover off. When I remove the cover, it has a nicely made circuit board with three ICs on it. But the most amazing thing is that the three ICs are microprocessors, all three in a row. They're microchip 16F54 chips, but they don't seem to have any inputs. They have a crystal that provides a clock signal to each one, and each one has an output that goes to a transistor that drives a little transformer, but the transformers don't seem to go to anything, and they don't have any outputs connected. They're just blank holes here. So what could this possibly do? Well, guesses so far are that it's a quantum faster-than-light computer, which would explain the name on the front.
Yeah.
And everybody knows quantum computers don't need mice or keyboards or output for video displays, so it could be that. It could be a Tesla free energy machine if it puts out more power than it uses, but it doesn't seem to have any outputs.
We found it, by the
way. So my best guess so far is that it's a detector for Bigfoot, aliens, or UFOs. And you select the type of alien you want to detect on the switch here on the back. Then adjust the sensitivity. And then whether a gray or reptilian alien gets nearby, the green LED will start flashing. So if anybody has any better guesses, let me know.
Very interesting.
Well,
so,
of course,
the chat room.
Our chat room, Steve C., has found it.
Okay.
They did, right?
They did. Kyle has found the exact... You can buy this on Amazon. Let me read you the title. It is the Quantum Pro with Quantum Electronic Noise Reduction System, the QNRS, for up to 5,000 square feet. For up to 5,000 square feet, home or office. Wow. That's not a very well named
title.
What
does it do?
I'm not sure.
Plug it into an electric outlet.
Creates a supportive environment for activity and rest. Benefits are automatic and cumulative over time. Energy, effect, environmentally friendly, and maintenance-free 3-year warranty.
Oh, supports the natural connection between individual and cosmic intelligence.
For greater fulfillment in life.
What is the price?
We need to start
this?
A Kickstarter and resell these, Dick. I think we have our plan. Product description. Increase the coherence of your environment to create a supportive space for yoga, deeper, more effective meditations. Some word I have no idea.
Yeah, Mom's word said it's a snake oil box.
It is a snake oil box.
Or a hocus pocus machine.
It's a snake oil box that they put a lot of work into, it seems like.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh. I also like how this is a snake oil box that you might actually have the settings wrong for.
That's it. Chad, look at the price. New from $495.
Do you want to buy this for five? You have the most expensive gadget we've shown on the warehouse yet.
Wow. And you didn't even have to pay the $5.49 shipping.
Oh my gosh, Steve, you found the mother load. I can't believe that. I mean, it is, to me, really funny that you could plug this device in and you say, it's not working. And you go, oh, well, do the numbers on the back say 5 or 6? Because I've had a lot of trouble with 5. You may want to set it to 6. You have your settings wrong. That's why it's incorrect.
And you'll see that you will suddenly calm down. And if you need energy, go back to 5. But 6 is really the most relaxing number that we can find.
I think that Steve was really close with the Bigfoot and UFO.
A UFO alien detector was very close. As a matter of fact, I think that's what we'll be selling it at when we give it the Giz Wiz seal of approval.
This just seems like a fire hazard to me. You plug power into it, might
and leave a lot of loose wires inside. Just
those wires may have gone to that back plate that had all the numbers on it.
That's true. That's
possibly. But wow, that is hilarious. That is such a good warehouse. And thank you. Let me scroll back up in the chat room to congratulate.
So, Steve, you'll get a copy of Mad Magazine, the current issue of Mad. You'll get one of those 35-year-old Alfred E. Newman photos. You'll get Fame and Fortune. That's assuming you live in the U.S. I guess you do. So we're looking for more videos. We could use Run Wide Away because next week I'm doing something on Thursday. Chad's doing something on Wednesday, so we're recording on Tuesday next week. So we need a gadget warehouse. So looking for videos from new people like Steve C. here, who found the gadget for, I've forgotten the video if he said how much he paid, but he didn't know what it was, but he just liked it and he bought it. And it turned out he has a $495 piece of
junk.
snake oil.
It's a snake oil gadget.
Electronic snake oil technology. So send your video, make a little video, put it on YouTube. When you go to YouTube, there's a drop-down menu. Hit unlisted. Then only people with the link that YouTube will give you can watch it. 2 to 3 minutes, send it to us at mail@gizwiz.tv. And the only standards are please use horizontal, not up straight up and down, vertical with your phone. And just make sure we can hear you and see whatever the gadget is. And we're open to anything. Like Steve just opened up a brand new category for us. It's kind of a what the heck is it? I guess it's called what the heck did I buy? Okay.
Yeah.
And the chat room found it. That's the
that's
best.
That's awesome.
The chat room found it.
Kyle,
and the find was really super.
And Steve C is actually in the chat room.
Oh, great.
And confirms that the wires went to the switch on the back. And also says, I only saw the green LED come on. I didn't feel supported at all. great.
Well, yeah, click it to the other side, Steve, and plug it in again.
You don't have your settings right. The settings are just incorrect, and then you'll feel supported. Kyle Lee is who found it on Amazon. With that, let's jump into the letter!
And Steve, when you put it on eBay, be sure to put the balloon as seen on TV, because now it has.
As seen on podcast.
As seen on podcast. It gets our first Giz Wiz seal of approval. letter of the week, hi Dick and Chad. I wanted Chad to know that there are about these USB extension cables.
Oh, please.
I think they will solve Chad's USB extension cable problem. USB active extension cables. I use them when I extend my USB camera or mic. They work flawlessly and they have never given out. Here's a link to the one I found on Amazon. But I believe any active USB extension cable will work. I never bought a bad one. The reason I know about them, I own a Mac Pro from 2009, and no regular USB extension cable worked. Then I read about these. I bought one, then two, then three, and so on. I still have them today, and I use them today. And it's signed by Mo or Moses. Oh, okay. So Mo or Moses is a big fan of the show. So I never heard of powered USB, but you probably have, right?
I have, and unfortunately, these are the powered USB cables that we're currently using on the show. We still get those crazy artifacts on the webcams. It could be that there's so many issues that it could be, but yeah, thank you so much for the suggestion. It is true that there is a big difference between active USB and basically a pass-through, a passive USB, is that as the USB gets longer, it loses power. So if you get a specific type of USB cable, it'll pull enough power to repeat it, basically, right there at the connection and help you out. So
maybe that little box that Steve C. has, you could just put it on the desk. It just might solve everything.
Exactly. I think that's why I'm not supported. Now, my tallest has a pretty interesting thing that he just put in the chat room, which is a USB to Ethernet to USB situation here. So you plug in USB there, and then you plug it into Ethernet, and then it goes over to the other side. That looks pretty interesting because that'll go pretty far. That looks good. That might be what I end up trying. There are only $11.50 at mono price. I am willing to try anything at this point. I spent hours after last show trying to figure it out. I'm pretty positive it is a. I have too many webcams on one USB controller, but being able to pick the correct USB controller. There's a USB controller view that you can do, but it's kind of complicated. Anyway, I think that's it, but it may not be it. We're going to keep trying to get these glitches, that glitch you just saw.
Oh, yeah, I know. That's the first one I saw today.
Yeah, so those things.
Where you're making the cables angry, basically, is
they're
what's
mad.
Happening.
There goes another glitch. Yes, exactly. So those glitches is what we're trying to get rid of.
Yeah.
So there we go. Thank you so much for the suggestion. If anyone else has suggestions, please send them my way. Always open to hear more. With that, we want to give a big thank you to our patrons. Patreon.com is a place for you to support independent content creators like ourselves. Patreon.com/GizWiz is our page. Big thanks to all the people who support the show every week. We have ours set up that every episode you guys give us a little something, even something small, even a dollar, even less than a dollar, whatever. Thank you so much for the support, and we really appreciate it. And big thank you to all the patrons who have pledged and who do support the show every time we upload. You guys really do make the show happen.
You know, we are soon coming up to 2 years of independent shows. Let me just look. This is show 99.
What? Next episode
show
will be
99 of independent contract. Well, it would have to be show 104, right? That would be 2 full years.
Yeah. Is that right? So, you're right.
Yeah. Right. You know, one show
52.
A week for 52.
Oh, I was thinking just next show is 100.
100.
We've done 100
we'll celebrate
episodes.
Then. We'll celebrate 104. We'll
That's
celebrate
great.
Every damn.
Every episode we celebrate. That's fantastic. That's incredible.
Thanks, yeah.
And that
because
can only happen
John
because of our
patrons. The whole thing.
It's so great. Thank you so much. We do understand that some people don't want to give every episode, and if that's you, you can have it because of our patrons.
The whole thing.
Sorry for that echo. That was me going to our website and not muting it fast enough. If you want to support only once or twice, then head on over to the website and click the Patreon button. And right underneath that banner is a PayPal link. Hey, while you're on the website, why don't you subscribe? This is where we're also live every Thursday around 7:30 Pacific time, about 4:30 Pacific time, 7:30 Eastern, if we're ever incorrect. Like next week, we're going to be a little bit off schedule because of some of the things we have to do throughout the week. It'll be right up here in this red banner, so you know exactly when the next episode is. We kind of have two sites. We have gizwiz.biz and gizwiz.tv. They're sister sites to each other. Gizwiz.biz, Dick runs and has all of the show notes for all the gadgets. It also has the What the Heck Is It game. And this is the gadget we're trying to figure out what the heck it is. It's pretty obvious to me. This is a dual potato slicer. You got one potato on one side, another potato on the other side. You slice them. Use both hands, slice and dice, get those potatoes peeled. It's pretty obvious to me. But if you think you know what this gadget is the whole gadget, not just a piece of it, not just a part of it, Then get a guessin' over at gizwiz.biz. There's 12 Mad Magazines signed by Dickie D himself for correct answers, or 24 for hilarious, clever, and interesting answers. I think that about wraps it up for this episode. See ya next week.
I'll be here.